I really want to thank you to be here. I'm very honored to have this opportunity to meet you in Shanghai. So first of all, how many of you have run workloads with GPU? Quite a few. And also, AliCloud offered a GPU sharing and scheduling solution in February this year. How many of you have heard of it or tried? Okay, also quite a few. So in February this year, AliCloud Container Service Team have this GPU sharing and scheduling solution and make it open. And we know that many friends have used this solution. This solution have helped you to save cost. So today I want to share with you this solution and the inspiration behind it. Maybe we can have a further discussion about how to refine this solution. Thank you. To start with, allow me to introduce myself. My name is Che Yang. I'm from the AliCloud Container Service Team. I've been working on using container technology to improve the heterogeneous computing in AliCloud. And this is my co-worker, Zhang Kai. He's responsible for the AliCloud Container Service Team. Cloud native AI. He has rich experience in cloud computing, distributed system, and SOA. And, maybe he will join the Q&A session later. So a bit of background introduction. So since in 2016, there was a famous game competition between AlphaGo and a world champion. And now, 3 years have passed, and AI have been implemented in many scenarios. For example, we have the smart robot or smart customer service, facial recognition, and AI translation.
So what drive the AI develop so fast? One of the reasons is the Nvidia GPU. In a specific scenario, it can improve the efficiency of the computing. In the past, we will take several months and several dozens of the days to do the calculation, but currently we can only finish it within several days or even several hours. Why the GPU is faster than the CPU? Well, actually, it's related to the process scenario as well as the system architecture. What is the main difference between the CPU and GPU? Which is, I think it lies in the core number. The CPU would have several or dozens of the core number, but GPU would be different. For the really old generation of the GPU, for example, the main time, it will have at least hundreds of the core number, but for the V100, it has 5,120 cores. So the use the space to save the time, and this kind of the physical advantage is really useful for large scale battery calculation in the scenario of the deep learning. And when the GPU core number reach a specific level, it needs some technology such as the Kubernetes. This kind of the cluster management technology and scheduling technology to manage the GPU, but how the Kubernetes would manage the GPU? And after the 1.8 version of the Kubernetes, Kubernetes will be defined by a device plugin. So it supports not only the GPU, but FPGA, RDMA, and other heterogeneous resources. So this kind of the difference can be divided into two parts. First one is the extendable resource. So if you support GPU, FPGA, or FDMA, you need to give it a name. So it can be realized via an API. Another thing is that all these kind of the companies provide this kind of the service, such as AMD and Nvidia, in order to realize a device plugin. It is quite simple actually. It only have two processes. One is the resource upload or resource reports, and how many devices you have, and how many GPU do you have, what are the IDs of the GPU. And the second one is when we schedule the jobs or the tasks, the containers, which is scheduled running, must be combined to the machine. So no matter what you support, GPU or FPGA, you can use this solution, but it has a problem. What's that? You can see that the scheduling of the device, it has only happened above this node. But for the scheduler, it only add or reduce the resource. But in the complicated scenarios, this kind of the information, this kind of the information is not enough. For example, I would like to schedule two GPU which is connected with the NI link. So if we don't extend the scheduler on the at the node, it cannot meet the physical top requirement. So all these are the disadvantage or limitation of the Kubernetes scheduler for the GPA. So I don't think it will give enough support for the heterogeneous device. Well, actually, we provide a container service on the Ali cloud. A lot of the clients approach us and ask that whether you can provide a solution to realize the sharing of the GPU. The purpose is to reduce the cost. For example, whether we can use the peak load shifting method to transfer the runtime, transfer the applications run on the devices and to another GPU. And on the Ali cloud, some clients also have their own API authorization so that they can apply for resources by themselves. But for other clients, they need to go through the P1 process. So maybe they can use this kind of the resource compression way to reduce the cost. So all these kind of the challenges is that whether we can use the Kubernetes to schedule the GPU, share the GPU, and currently the scheduling mechanism of the Kubernetes makes it simple. It must be scheduled one by one. The second one is separation. When we run different applications on different GPU, separation is really important. How can we ensure that one is not interfering with another? The immediate has two methods. One is the EVGU, but it must be achieved in the different levels. So it is quite difficult for us to make it control. A second problem of the vGPU is that on default, it needs to support some license for the Nvidia. It must be paid. And the third one, it is not so flexible. For our clients, they would like to reduce the cost by peak load shifting. So I don't think that this kind of isolation way is suitable for us. Another one is the MPS, multiple process service. And this kind of the shared method can be done in the machine, but it can only be run on the Volta series. And we already tested that in the production environment. It is not really available. In some testing environments, the MPS client terminal had the crash problem, which will affect other terminals which is connected to the same terminals. And now we are working with the Nvidia to solve these problems. So let's go back to our problems. Our clients would like to share the GPU and to realize the scheduled GPU. In the we hope that this kind of the scheduling method can be simple. And at this moment, we need to focus on the scheduling. But for the isolation, we can realize it by trade-off. And third, we cannot change the core code of the Kubernetes because we are the on-cloud service provider. We know that Kubernetes develops really fast, and currently it already reached the 1.15 version. And the minor versions and the safety plugins will be launched even more frequent. So if we change the core code, and we need to invest a lot regarding in order to maintain it. And another problem is that once we change the core code, this kind of the method cannot be copied, cannot be extended for other users. If they need to have their own method, it is quite complicated. So that's why we don't want to change the core code of the Kubernetes to solve these problems. And isolation of the resources is not our focus anymore. So let's go back to our challenge. Currently, we don't have any solutions available in the community, so we need to start to tackle the challenges from the scratch. We need to do two things. The first one, how should we define the API? How the customers would use the system? How do they apply for the resource? And the second is that what is the architecture we use to support this kind of the request? So let's have a look at the first question. And how can we design the interaction interface when we talk to different kind of clients? We found that when they need to use the shared GPU, well, actually, they need the shared GPU in the scenario of the module prediction. So at this scenario, they can assume an assumption, which is the computing capacity of the GPU is in positive relationship and with the memory. And then we will transfer the sharing of the GPU to a challenge about the usage and the allocation of the special resources. And this kind of the definition is easy to be accepted by the users. And second one is that we will divide a device plugin, and which is a memory of the GPU. But is that enough? No, I don't think so. If we can do this at this kind of spec, I don't think it's enough. And for the traditional Kubernetes juggler, they are not really capable. They can only add or reduce some things. And the result is that after the scheduling, the memory resources would be fragmented. I will cover that later. To be simple, after the frequent scheduling, if there are several cards, the total GPU can meet the requirements of the users, but actually they always have some problem. And when users have a really large requirement of the scheduling, there must be a failure. So we need to add a scalable schedule to have a finer binding and filter. So in our design, there are two core modules. One is the GPU shared scheduler extender, which is responsible for the scheduler. The main difference between this one and the native one is that the scheduler has already been improved to the scheduling layer, but for the GPU shared device plugin would be the one who is execute the scheduler extender, assigning results. So let's see what is the extending scheduler does. Just imagine that when the users apply for the memory of the 4 GB, And in the traditional way, they found that the node and 1 and 2 and 4 can meet the requirements because the rest of the GPU memory is over 4. And in this way, we need to introduce the default scheduler to do the filtering. And then they found that N1 and N2 cannot meet the requirements. So let's take N1 as the example. Even though the rest is over 4, but the maximum memory for one card is 3 gigabytes, so it cannot meet the requirements of the scheduling. And the same for the N2, the maximum is 2 only, so only N3 can meet the requirements. So this one explains the role of the scheduler extender. It can do the more specific scheduling task. So the next one is binding to the node. When the GPU is binding to the node, it is quite different from the traditional way. In the past, they only schedule the node and filter the node, but currently what we do is that in the scheduler extender, we will filter the card by the pack way. So let's see this example. When the users apply for 4 gigabytes of the memory, GPU memory. We have 4 choices from GPU 0 to GPU 3, but we found that GPU 1 and GPU 2 cannot have the resources over 4. Only GPU 0 and GPU 3 can meet the requirements. In this way, we'll use the bin pack as a condition. The new application resources will be deployed to the allocated to the GPU 0, and the code imitation will be recorded as well. And it will be used as a reference for the schedulers. On this step, the device plugin is executing the decisions done by the previous level of the scheduler. All this kind of scheduling information, for example, the GPU resources and the occupation of the container on the GPU will be recorded in the environment variables and broadcast to the users, and that the decisions can be made, for example, the occupation of the GPU and the occupation of the container, etc.
In fact, it's easy to deploy this solution. We use this helm to deploy the GPU share on the Kubernetes cluster, and you can decide which plug you want to deploy in which namespace, and you can define the number of master supported, and you complete this installation. And also, on this basis, you need to define the which nodes will want this GPU sharing. You can just add the label when it's done. And also, in order to strengthen the management and the monitoring, we have this kubectl as an extension and help you to check the resource distribution of GPU sharing. It's easy to use. So it has this extension command. It provides the, it helps you to monitor the resource available on each node and total resource available and the total resource. When you apply for a node to use the GPU sharing, there's no big difference to the traditional approach. You just change the GPU limit into the GPU.com AliCloud. Then that would be fine. You just need to change that specification and identify the number or the capacity of video memory required. That would be done. And in reality, when you truly run it, you can see the environment variables in the container. One is the GPU memory on the current device, the total amount of the GPU memory on the current device. And the second is the GPU memory for the container. So through the TF session, you can use it to control your GPU memory fraction.
Okay.
So now let's run a demo here. Let me see if live demo is possible or not. Can you see it clearly? Should I zoom it out? Okay. Is that clear?
Okay.
So when we use this feature, first, through kubectl, inspect GPU share. Through this command, then we can see that here is a node to use GPU share, and there is no application running on this node yet. So what's the application to be deployed? So this is a bin pack. I ran the Tensorflow.
So
this mini program, it said I need 12 gigabytes video memory. So we deploy it through the kubectl.
Okay.
And after we deploy it, let's see whether it can run now. Now we see the application is running. Then we can check the inspect. So here it shows that the application take 12 GIP. We can view more details
with
dashed. We can see which application occupy which specific part of the GPU. Now we can deploy a second application. It is also a bin-pack application. The memory, the video memory is just 3 GIB. Now we deploy it. After the deployment is done, we can use this inspect. With this inspect, we can see that in terms of scheduling, these two applications have been scheduled to GPU 1. And if we want to check more details, we can see that their specific GPU or the video memory occupied. Now we can log in to that machine just now. These are the nodes, these are the two nodes. These are the nodes running the two applications just now.
Here,
through Tensorflow fraction, we can set its video memory within a safe range. And through this graphical monitoring, so through Graphene we can monitor and view the GPU usage. So the number is the same.
But it's good to say when your requests are more, you can use a different place to control.
So with the same number of nodes, you can do monitoring here. It monitors the video memory and cores utilized, temperature. So that's pretty much about it. So for my presentation, I've talked about our design for GPU sharing and scheduling. So going forward, we are now using the MPS to integrate into our solution.
And also,
we hope to make this solution more universal. It will it can support your features. And we are thinking about the integration of MPS and make this solution universal or more applicable. So this is the QR code for our open source project. If you're interested, you can scan this QR code and try this project. And we look forward to your feedback. And here, AliCloud has its cloud native technology open course. And if you're interested, you can scan the QR code and enjoy this class. That's all for me. Thank you. Do you have any questions? I have several questions actually. First, at the moment, do you also consider about the training, GPU training and inference? Will you think about this training and inference for the same node? So for the GPU occupied alone and GPU sharing can be supported, but for one node, it is either exclusive GPU occupation or GPU sharing. So it is done by labeling, right? Yes. So the second question is that for different GPU, it is not only about a question of video memory, like 4 GB. And they, because of this different video memory, the processing capability is different. So for this video memory, would you provide a separate label so that user can appoint a specific GPU card for specific video memory? That's possible. We have discussed with our clients as well. For example, given the different computing capacity, we have talked with our clients as well. It's a trade-off, because if you choose sharing, then some performance may be compromised. We have asked about labeling requirements. Then some clients think it's fine. Well, of course, it depends on the clients. It depends on their needs. Like some people will use different models into the same cluster and decided not to add label. But if you think a label is necessary, then you can just add it. That's fine. Third question, when you talk is about MPS. So NPS may have feature loss by 10% or 20%. Do you have a specific number? Well, we test on V100. We also talk with our colleague. I didn't run a test. Well, for us, we ran the test on V100, but we don't see the performance loss. So for this V version, the performance, there is no performance loss. Okay, last question. Actually, the MPS itself did not control the usage of video memory, right? Yes. So for us, it's more about scheduling the business. And in execution, if we use the MPS for isolation, we couldn't control the actual usage. So for your solution, how do you deal with it? I think, first of all, you understand it right. For many clients, when they don't run on Kubernetes, they've already run many applications on the same GPU. So there are some limitations. And now the issue for them is that with the Kubernetes, it should be a progress. But the traditional approaches may not be applicable now. So first of all, they want to know whether this GPU can be distributed in a reasonable manner in this Kubernetes. So they hope to get a systematic scheduling. Regarding to isolation, I think it involves everyone. For MPS, we can set the MPS Kubernetes right. We can set the specification for video memory. If you use the Tensorflow, then you have to do it on your own. So that's all for me.
So
actually, gentlemen, asked the question that I also want to ask as well. So just now, you mentioned about you can group the well-performing GPU together. Well, first, I will talk about the Kubernetes scheduling, but here my focus is about GPU sharing. So your question is not within this topic. And later on, we can elaborate on that, maybe we have for the other presentation. But if you're interested, we can talk in private. But again, your question is not about today's topic, but we can talk privately.
Good afternoon. I will confirm that you use the MPS, right? Well, we are testing MPS, but we are really cautious about the MPS because the stability of the MPS is the main problem, especially for the online service. Yes, but from other channels, I knew that. And if you don't use the MPS, even though you share it, won't run the projects isolatedly. Yes, that's right. So that the utility of the GPU cannot meet 100% at some point, right? No. Well, actually, we need to cooperate with the usage team as well.
Okay.
I have a question about the memory allocation. For a lot of the GPU card can meet the requirements of the GPU extension, so do you rank it? For example, if the memory of the GPU is quite small, so that if it is ranking and usage, the fragments can be small as well. What do you mean? Well, actually, the memory card of the GPU are different. But actually, if the memory is large and then it is used for the sharing, it will have a lot of the fragments. Have you considered that at all? Yes, that's right. I think that is quite a good consideration. And this is our architecture currently. We have two hooks. One, it is computer. And another one is the prioritized. These kind of the prioritized points on the node haven't been done, and actually we can add that to our task as well. I think it is not a problem. Thank you.
Good
afternoon. I also have a question about scheduling. If there is a batch of the task has already been scheduled, so I would like to know that it will cause a fragmentation problem. So do you support the rescheduled process, which means that you can reschedule the task to a GPU which can meet the requirement of them, and then release a larger memory for a specific GPU for another task? Well, actually, it's about the rescheduling, right? Yes, right. And if I would like to do the rescheduling, I can need to improve the scheduler because it can only provide some hook point and all this kind of the hook point. It's only related to the service. We know that Kubernetes has already provided some ports for the prioritization, and which is doing what you just described, but they are not available for extension. Two questions are not really related to the GPU. One is that you do the scheduling via the filter standard. So what is the protocol of the filter? HTTP or what? HTTP. Okay. Have you encountered a problem of the bottleneck of the performance? Well, actually, the performance-related problem has already been encountered by us. But first, for the Kubernetes, support to the extended has already been scaled up. It supports some filter. What does that mean? It means that only the specific extended filter can be run or can be scheduled. It has some specific requirements. The expander will not be scheduled when there are some specific types of the requirement is applied. You use this kind of the special one for the default extendable resource. They can be filtered in the scheduler. If we combine this filter together, so that some requests cannot be received by the extender. Essentially, what you need to do is to segment this challenge. Another one. Well, actually, the time's up, so let's talk about it privately later. Thank you.